So looking at Noah, we can see that we have come a long way, a very long way. So we will speak a lot about companies as such today, and we'll learn a lot about companies, but I'm not sure if that's the right way to look at the scenery. So I would like to go two steps above and see if we do the framework in a decent way. And the framework is, for me, digitization and geopolitics. And it is important to change the view, because the view at the end defines how aggressively we take on this chance, and this chance is, and risk is way bigger than we think. So I want to lead you through three phases that Europe has historically gone through and that defined our prosperity. And if you look at it, there was a time when the first revolution was, it was about cultivation. The second was industrialization, and the third one is digitalization. So these trends made the fortune of a continent or disfavored the continent. So the cultivation basically was dependent on weather. It is a local political influence, and you had local capital. The industrialization then was about national industry policy and national capital, later global. So we see that Trump is pushing us with our 66 billion surplus in industry, in the trade surplus that we have. And that is the current state in the industrialization. But we mustn't be shy, and it is very dangerous to rely on the trade surplus, because when you look at the digitalization, we see that we, in the important areas, we lose. So in order to calibrate the risks that we have in the surplus, Lakestar did a survey with the Deutsche Institut für Wirtschaftsforschung, and as Christoph Mayr also alluded, we analyzed the notion of digital trade deficit. So, and we can see that currently your German-US relation runs at a trade deficit in digital of about 25 billion. So the important measure is not whether we have a 66 billion trade surplus in the industry in the old world, but we run at a 25 billion trade deficit in the digital world. On a European level, the digital trade deficit with the US is something like 68 billion. And on a German level, it's something like 26 billion. So why is that so important? Because these are the future industries that make the deficit. And these industries have network effects, and they are reinforcing, meaning we get in a very difficult spiral, in a negative spiral that increases the dependency we have. What levers do we have in Europe? So I do think we have, to get the right calibration, we have a political sphere and we have a financial sphere. And I'm not sure whether everybody understood the implications of going from a more national industry to a global industry. And I can identify certain games played, which we don't understand yet, which I would like to allude to. So the political sphere, the prerequisites aren't bad. So we have a big addressable market in comparison to the other ecosystems. We just are a little bit suboptimal structurally in order to speak with one voice. So things like a Brexit obviously don't help, but the more important thing is we do not have one voice. Everybody can speak with one voice, but we can't. So what we also do is, Europe is about regulation. So the US innovates, the Chinese copy, and we regulate. So that needs to change, because we have to change the lot side of the companies. We have, through regulation, 11 small telcos instead of 4 big ones in the US or in China. So if it comes to economies of scales, we are always subpar. So the domestic regulation is something that we need to think new. We have always are hindered by anti-competitive organizations that try to keep the industry small rather than allow them to get to a decent size. My favorite topic is also that we are pretty shy on fighting for our interests. So when we get pressured on the monopolies of the of Apple and Google, that's very, very difficult for European startups to find an ear in Brussels so that we can defend ourselves. And thirdly, which I think is obviously the weakest point, as you know, in organizations, nothing happens if there's not one person that has an ownership for a topic. So I don't feel that any of the countries has an ownership for digital on a political level. So it cannot be that these topics are distributed among different ministries and nobody has the responsibility to lead Europe or Germany into the next digital phase. So how can that look like? So we are the only ones that didn't do industry policy. The Chinese had this one voice in a very big market. And what is the result of it? Yeah, 20 years later, Baidu has 76% market share and Google 2% in China. And in Europe, Google has 92% market share and there is no single European search engine. I think we should step up politically so that this picture for Industry 4.0 in Europe looks like the China picture here. So now we have the financial sphere. Financial sphere has, I've seen that we play a totally different game, which we are not part of. So you know these charts that we invest way too little in comparison to all the other geographies. But here it comes to innovation. We spend in Europe a lot on R&D if it comes to industrials. But we are very weak if it comes to software and internet. So that is still in the R&D budgets we are underrepresented. Why is capital so crucial? Because it has become a geopolitical weapon. What I mean with that, I will explain. So the capital has, especially in the world where companies become so big that they have a political power, the capital and with capital, the representation in a cap table is political influence. So if you would control the board of a Google or a Facebook, then you could influence something. If you're not represented, then you have hardly any chance. Meaning, if we have a deficit in capital, as we have here in Germany, for example, that means that we are also exporting a loss of influence or importing. So what does it mean? Look at the big winners we have in Europe. So we have the Spotify's, the Klarna's, the AUTO1, the Zalando's. The decisive people in the cap tables become American. That means if decisions are made for our companies here in Europe, the European voice is hugely underrepresented. So what does it mean with the existing global platforms? These are the big global platforms. In what way would we as Europeans from the capital side would have any influence in them? So there were 132 investment rounds with these companies and 62 billion was invested. And European financing institutions participated only in 14% of these rounds. So that still looks quite okay, but now comes the real disaster number. The total invested capital of European entities in these top 20 digital platforms is 1.98%. And if it translates into influence, we are represented as Europeans in the decisive companies of the world with 1.44% in the cap table. Meaning we are nowhere. We are not invited into that game. We are totally marginalized if it comes to having influence on the big companies. So how is it played? I think there's one entity that has totally understood how to play that game. And this is SoftBank with the SoftBank Vision Fund. So SoftBank has set up this 93 billion fund and is structurally buying equity stakes in all the decisive companies in the world. So if you look at the top 30 companies which are most influential in the world digitally, which are not yet listed, they had a combined financing of $67 billion. And with the 93 billion fund, SoftBank could have done all the fundraisers of everybody would be the only one represented in the cap table, and that way, with the investors' right, they would basically have a say in every of these companies. That is what happens fast forward the next 20 years if you have a geopolitical weapon like a big capital fund. So that means bypassing national political rules just by the representation in cap tables and exercising the power that arises from that. So to sum up, if we want to really, really make a difference in the framework of the digital industry, Brussels needs to speak with one voice. We need to have one GSG9, yeah, that is very fast in reacting, that can have huge penalties if people do not play like network or platform neutrality-wise in order to protect our businesses. And I think the perception of Europe has to be that we need to free up the capital sitting idly in insurances, having no yield currency currently. And you have to use this capital to actively become a player in this capital game and using this influence over the cap structure in order to be seen in the digital world. That's it. Thank you very much.